Welcome everyone to today's Council on Foreign Relations virtual book launch for The Last Shah, America, Iran, in the Fall of the Pahlavi Dynasty by Ray Takeyh, the Hasib J. Sabbagh Senior Fellow for Middle East Studies here at the Council. It's a great pleasure for me to be here moderating tonight's discussion. Ray and I have been colleagues for many years, probably more years than either of us wishes to count. During that time, Ray has written well and widely on Iran and a range of issues in the Middle East more broadly, including four very well-received books. And it's Ray's fifth book and his latest book, The Last Shah, that brings us here tonight. So I want to begin by welcoming Ray and congratulating him on the publication of The Last Shah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now, Ray, I want to begin by saying this is a terrific book. It is deeply researched, it is beautifully written, and it directly challenges the wisdom or the conventional wisdom about Iran's last Shah, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi. And I want people not to take my word on it. I'm a bit biased being the director of studies here at the Council, but it's already gotten a lot of praise. I'll note that the late Marvin Zonis, who himself wrote quite extensively on Iran, said that books on 20th century Iran abound, but none deliver the substance or insight that Ray Takeyh does. And Michael Duran hailed your book in the Wall Street Journal as an original interpretation that puts Iranian actors where they belong at center stage. So very high praise, Ray, and congratulations.
Thank you.
We're going to follow standard procedure tonight. I'm going to ask Ray questions for about 25 minutes or so, and then we're going to open up our conversation for questions. We have more than 350 people registered for our event tonight, and we'll do our best to get in as many questions as possible when we open up the conversation. But Ray, where I want to begin is with the book. And as I read The Last Shah, it can be thought of as a history of Iran. It can be thought of as a history of U.S.-Iranian relations. But at its core, it's a history of a leader, Mohammad Reza Shah. Now, he is often depicted in history books as a powerful and ruthless puppet of the United States. But in The Last Shah, you paint a very different picture of the man. Can you tell us a bit about it?
Sure. To suggest the least, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi was a complicated figure. He had a thirst for autocracy and he had an autocratic personality. He spent most of his life deriding democracy as a useless Western experiment. But yet he had difficulty making tough decisions. I think the great Persian scholar Anne Lampa said he's a dictator who cannot dictate. And for many years of his life, when Iran had real institutions and real politicians and real leaders, he tended to rely on them during the times of crises. And by 1970s, late 1970s, when he had eviscerated Iran's institutions and he has disposed of the men of caliber who could make independent decisions and deal with the crisis, he was basically alone facing the most important existential crisis of his tenure, ultimately one that consumed his presidency. So he had a thirst for autocracy, but inability, didn't have the personality and the strength to actually go through with the difficult decisions that often been made. And one of his prime ministers said to him that, you know, if you want absolute power, you will be absolutely responsible for all the problems of Iran, all the problems of a country where things frequently went wrong.
So let's talk a little bit about how he came to power, because often the story of Shah is told of having other people put him in power. He came to rule at a very young age, I think roughly 21, when his father was pushed out. So you can sort of talk a little bit about sort of the early years of the Shah?
The early years were difficult ones for him. In 1941, he had come to power because the British and the Russians had invaded Iran as part of their grand strategy for the war. And they had deposed his father, who was a real autocrat with an autocratic personality. And they essentially then debated whether Iran should essentially have a monarchy. They debated whether returning the defunct Qajar dynasty, even a republic, but for lack of better choice, they decided, okay, here you go. And from then on, he was in the shadow of others, but it is important to recognize that despite his weaknesses and deficiencies, and they were certainly profound, from the very beginning, he was determined to be a powerful ruler who left his imprint on the country. And he began to essentially try to do as much as he can to accumulate power gradually and relentlessly. It was very difficult. The obstacles were quite formidable. Iran was an occupied country. The parliament and the prime ministers and the politicians and the aristocratic class, the landed gentry, the clerical estate, the prying and vibrant press, actually, they all had a say and they all had a stake. So he had to negotiate and navigate these particular pitfalls. And it took him a long time. At the height of his arrogance in the mid-1970s, he was asked, how long did it take you to get absolute power the way you do? He said it was a 20-year journey from the time I came to power. So from 1941, he essentially tries to accumulate more power, use the institutional monarchy and its prerogatives to gain that power. And he eventually does so to the detriment of his own rule. But he was a combination of insecurity and strength. I should say the Shah had a vision for the country. He wanted to industrialize Iran. He wanted to modernize the country. There is a benign aspect to his rule. He does create the modern middle class. He does create the infrastructure. He created his universities, hospitals, bridges, and airports. He manages to essentially safeguard Iran's sovereignty. But in terms of his domestic management of the political affairs and political institution, well, you know, his takes for autocracy rebounded to his disadvantage, I would say.
I want to get to this question of the benign aspect of the Shah's agenda, Ray. But before we do that, I want to talk about that 20-year period where he was trying to consolidate power, because he almost didn't make it to the 20-year mark. Perhaps one of the things almost everyone knows about U.S.-Iranian relations is that a gentleman named Mossadegh became very powerful, was pushing the Shah aside. And then, so the story goes, the United States engineered a coup in 1953 that brought the Shah back. But you tell a very different story about the events and developments of the 1951 to 1953 period. Can you tell us a bit about that?
The oil nationalization crisis that began in 1951 and really went on to 1970s, actually. When you think about the coup, there are two ways of looking at it. Number one is the mechanics of the coup. What happened when, who did what? What happened in August 1953? The second question about the coup is its implications for Iranian policy and politics. And too many people have drawn a straight line between 1953 and 1979, as if the intervening generation didn't matter. The 25 years of decision-making were inconsequential. Essentially, they suggest that 1953 made 1979 possible, if not inevitable. What I try to suggest is the Iranian political system before 1953 and after 1953 doesn't change fundamentally. The Shah still tries to gain power. After 1953, Iran is not necessarily into an autocratic dictatorship. The parliament still matters. There's strong personalities. It is my estimation that the hinge years in Iranian policy, in Iranian politics, in Iranian modern history, was not 1953, but 1961 to 1962. The last consequential prime minister of Iran was not Dr. Mossadegh, was Ali Amini, in the sense that he was capable of standing up to the Shah, making his own decision, undertaking his own initiative, almost independent of the monarchy. The window closes in 1960s, and you begin to see the autocracy in its full form. Now, to get back to the question of the mechanics of the coup, which to me is less important than the implications of the coup for the political system of Iran. Well, the mechanics of the coup, there are actually not one, but two coups. One takes place, I believe, on August 15th. And everybody's sort of in agreement with that. There was an Iranian military attempt to overthrow Dr. Mossadegh, and the CIA was complicit in that, and that fails. And at that time, Washington essentially gives up on the coup. There is another coup on August 19, and that's the area of controversy between individuals. It's a controversy that may never be resolved. What happened on the afternoon of August 19th? What did Kermit Roosevelt, the American agent, do? And what did all the Iranians do? If you believe, as I do, that Iran at that time had very strong personalities, General Zahedi and others, it is my opinion that they the ones who essentially assumed most of the control in August of 1953. And to go back to that afternoon, what did Kermit Roosevelt do? Well, one of the most important things he did was to distribute the Shah's orders dismissing Dr. Mossadegh, gaining it widespread attention. That's not a nefarious thing to do. It's actually informing the Iranian people through international press and therefore domestic press that the Shah had dismissed his prime minister, Dr. Mossadegh, and he had appointed General Zahedi to replace him. As nefarious CIA plots go, that seems kind of simple, but not without importance and consequence. So it is very difficult, despite what everybody thinks, to suggest why a coup succeeds. Who bears agency? Who bears responsibility? I would say that about Guatemala. I would say that about Chile. I would say about anything. So to ascribe definitive, absolute blame on one actor or the other, I think misses the complexity of the coup and the ambiguity of the history. As I said, it's an argument without an end. It is my opinion, based on evidence that I've seen, including recently released evidence in 2017, which were many intelligence reports and CIA reports, that if you want to assign responsibility for who was mostly in charge in August of 1953, you should look to the Iranians. And one of the things I will say about this book, and I think it was captured in the Wall Street Journal article, is I have tried to put Iranians in control of their history. They take ownership of the history. If you look at the 1953 coup, the reason why the conventional wisdom has persisted for so long is because it is a unique and seamless amalgamation of two political cultures. A Persian political culture that doesn't want to take responsibility for difficult decisions, and the Americans who thinks all about them. East meets West, and they have built the Golden Bridge. Throughout this book, my point has always been that the principal drivers of Iranian history during this period, and those principally responsible for decisions of the country, are the Iranians themselves.
Well, let's draw on that thread, Ray, and talk about the consequences of the Shah emerging and surviving the Mossadegh period. You mentioned that he still faced several powerful prime ministers, powerful other actors in the political arena, but he also had an agenda. The Shah was seeking to modernize, yes, really try to fundamentally change Iranian society and the Iranian economy. Sort of walk us through that, how he did it, and how it played out.
It is important to suggest that the Shah had institutional power. He had constitutional power, and he began to use that. And one of the things you can say about the Iranian elite at that time is they acquiesced to his power because they respected the institution of the monarchy. The Shah's vision for Iran was very much a modernizing vision, which was quite in vogue at that time throughout the Middle East and the developing bloc. He wanted to turn the country from agricultural to industrial, from illiterate to literacy, from countryside to urbanization. His model for development was the Western bloc and the Western industrial countries. He wanted to sort of transform Iran into a country. And along the way, he did some remarkable things. The land reform measures that he instituted was really the first time in Persia's history that powerful landlords were forced to give land to the peasants. It didn't work completely. The land reform is a very complicated thing. It has a number of different stages. But at the end of it, the feudal system was essentially broken, and many peasants had their own land. Even the Islamic Republic has published statistics suggesting 2 million peasants actually began to become landlords and landholders after that time. So he essentially wanted a sort of a vision of Iran around industrial, sort of mimicking the industrial countries of the West. He talked about Iran as the Japan of the Middle East, a country that was developing scientific technology. And for that, he needed a middle-class cadre that was essentially Western trained. And one of the things, one of the mistakes that he made, or one of the many mistakes that he made, he assumed that only great men who are dictators can achieve great things. That parliamentary bickering, aristocratic intrusions, a prying press, they get in the way of modernization of the country. And in order for him to achieve this vision, he had to centralize power and eviscerate Iran's civic institutions. The modernization succeeded unevenly, not without corruption, but in the process, he destroyed institutions that could have buffered the crisis when the crisis inevitably came.
You note, Ray, that the Shah embraced the Western model of modernization. And obviously, one of the parts of this story is his relationship with the United States. The United States turns and looks to Iran as one of the major pillars of its policy in the Middle East. But on the other hand, as you write, much of Iranian policy under the Shah was about gaining authority and control over oil pricing, which ran counter to what Washington wanted and expected. So can you sort of walk us through this relationship between Tehran and Washington?
If the Shah was an American client, he was a rather obstreperous one. He certainly had a mind of his own. I would say in terms of all the presidents that dealt with the Shah, starting with Franklin Roosevelt through President Carter, every president, with the exception of Richard Nixon, asked the Shah to reform his politics and focus on his economy, not the military buildup. Every Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense that dealt with the Shah during the time of his military buildup in the late 60s, which was reckless, and it took a lot of the budget away from pressing domestic needs, from Robert McNamara through Don Rumsfeld, through Harold Brown, advised against it. One of the American presidents, paradoxically, who was most insistent that Shah reform his politics and liberalize it, was Dwight Eisenhower.
Who you have written about, I should note.
Right. Dwight Eisenhower was very frustrated with the Shah after 1953 for his despotic tendencies. John Kennedy was another one who actually pressed upon the Shah to reform. But by mid-60s, from the American perspective, the Shah was a successful ruler. He was in command of his country. He had launched a very successful national white revolution, which was industrializing and distributing land to the peasants. And America was overburdened by Vietnam and was looking for proxies and allies to control critical regions of the universe. Shah was, from their perspective, successful. And remember, as you know, Jim, this was a time when Americans were in thrall of the modernization theory, where they essentially believed that strong governments in control of strong institutions can do good things. And eventually, in Walt Rousseau's vision, that would be a prelude to democratization. Now, strong governments came, democratization never did. So from the American perspective in mid-1960s, the Shah was a successful ruler. And once you get to, of course, Richard Nixon and America, as I said, that was looking for clients abroad, for allies abroad, decided that the Shah could be a useful policeman of the Gulf at the time when that region was volatile and America was overburdened. And the Shah was most readily willing to comply in terms of what he wanted to do. I would say just one thing, the Shah's foreign policy was actually nothing short of brilliant. He had a good relationship with the United States, a good relationship with the Soviet Union, a good relationship with the emerging bloc in emerging Chinese power, good relationship with Europe, good relationship with all the neighboring states, with the exception of Iraq. He was, from the American perspective, and legitimately so, a very successful international player who was willing to essentially preserve the stability of the region at the time when the United States was too overburdened to focus on it.
So I have to ask then, Ray, how do we go from a Shah who in the early to mid-1970s looks like he's riding high? He has good relations with all of the major powers, as you just described. He has helped engineer this revolution in the oil market, which is bringing a lot yes. more money into Iran. Yet 5 years later, his dynasty comes to the end. I mean, the title of your book is The Last Shah. How did that happen?
Well, to some extent, he was bedeviled by his own success. He had created a modern middle class that in Iran then, as in today, was not willing to live with the transaction that he offered. The transaction would be monetary rewards in exchange for political passivity. and they wanted to have a say in their politics. And he was not allowing any sort of avenue for political expression, which was wrong. He had, as I mentioned, emasculated historic institutions such as the parliament. Iran was undergoing a religious revival at that time. The Middle East was in its entirety, but you began to see the rise of religion in terms of pilgrimages, religious books being sold well, and religion eventually becomes an ideology of dissent. The Shah's regime was corrupt. There was massive corruption. That's not unusual in developing countries, but in this particular case, the corruption was particularly glaring. There were class cleavages. The connections to the Pahlavi dynasty mattered more than one's professional competence. And by the time you get to the mid-1970s, when you have the global recession, that affects the Shah's economy as well. It affects the regional economies as well. But by the time he faces that crisis, and he understood that there's a crisis, he understood that his public was disengaged from the politics of the courts. He understood that the court was too aloof and distant. He understood the problems. And by the way, so did the Americans. Just because you understand the problems, that doesn't mean you can fix them.
Fair point.
And his attempts to fix the problems essentially created additional conflict and crises for him. And when the crisis came, when the demonstrations and the popular uprising came, he was too indecisive to be able to handle the crisis. And the military he created was as indecisive as he was in terms of stepping in and handling the situation, as everybody anticipated.
Well, I take it you do not see the revolution as being inevitable, but the function of choices that the Shah made or didn't make. And if that's correct, what do you think the big mistakes were that he made?
No historical event is inevitable. The question, therefore, is at which point, I think, could the Shah's dynasty have been preserved? At which point could events have taken a different turn? In my opinion, the turning point where things may have been differently was early 1970s. Before the buildup of the military, before devoting 40% of the budgets for armaments that he didn't need and his army couldn't use, before all the stuff that went on. At that time, I think if he had taken a different course, he had gradually liberalized his politics, he had focused more on domestic pressing needs, greater distribution of wealth, focusing on essentially developing the country further, and giving people an opportunity to participate in their politics, things may have been different. But he didn't have the capacity or the capability of doing so. He understood that he needed to revive the civic institutions that he had destroyed, but he didn't know how to do it. So his liberalization program was ham-fisted. It invited criticism without providing a channel for political participation. And he faced in Iran at that time a country which was undergoing a religious revival. I believe at that time it had 9,000 mosques. That's a national network that no political party can match, and it's a national network that no secret police can repress.
Did he miss an opportunity to keep the religious establishment on his side? Was it inevitable that Khomeini would come to the forefront?
Well, the question you're asking is an extraordinary serious one, is how did Khomeini exercise hegemony over the clerical institution? And I think that has to do with a series of mistakes that Shah made. And you can talk about specifically when he essentially signaled out Khomeini in a vicious attack in the 1978 press article, which further emboldened Khomeini. It is my opinion, actually, had he been more magnanimous in early 1978, had given Khomeini an opportunity to return to Iran, then Khomeini would be part of the larger landscape of oppositionist leaders. He would not have been the dominant figure, and he would have to negotiate and talk to the government as it constituted itself. It is my view that Khomeini could only have dominated Iran by staying outside it, because he could be maximalist. He could never concede. And his fundamental inhumanity means he was, you know, indifferent to the human cost of his decisions. Whatever the Shah's fault, and God knows there were many, Shah was cynical, certainly duplicitous, but he wasn't cruel. And he ultimately didn't have the stomach for the bloodshed, and in my opinion, a military that could discharge that.
Well, Ray, you know, the story of the Iranian Revolution in the United States is often told not about what the Shah did or didn't do, but what about the president at the time, Jimmy Carter, did or didn't do. And maybe that whole line of argument would be summed up in the question, did Jimmy Carter lose Iran?
No, Jimmy Carter did not lose Iran. No American tried harder to thwart the revolution than Jimmy Carter. No American tried harder to support Carter. The Carters, as emerging from documentary record, is a different one than we have known in our imagination. In the 1980s, Ronald Reagan used to tell the story all the time that Jimmy Carter came to him in a dream and said, "Why do you want my job?" And Reagan responded, I don't want your job. I want to be president." That sort of has stuck in people's mind. Let's see what Jimmy Carter did. Jimmy Carter advised the Shah to actually repress the revolution. Jimmy Carter tried to form some kind of a coup to preserve the tatters of the monarchy in February 1979. And in aftermath of the revolution, Jimmy Carter committed himself to a regime change policy in Iran. I'm going to go to the glasses on this one and read a presidential finding. This is a presidential finding from December 1979. Presidential findings, as you know, are what presidents have to order, issue when they're ordering a covert operation that increases a certain beyond a certain budget. If, with your permission, I'll read it. Here's a description of a presidential finding that Jimmy Carter signed. Using any and all possible means, including taking or encouraging the network of agents or other contacts in foreign countries, clandestine radio broadcasting, and the use of media placements to cause the distribution or broadcast in foreign countries of non-attributable propaganda for purpose of influencing the Khomeini, other religious and political leaders, and anti-American sentiment to abandon or moderate anti-American political and economic system to protect the safety of U.S. nationals. In essence, what Carter essentially issues is a plan for overthrowing the Khomeini regime, and he established a group in the White House called, interesting enough, the Black Chamber Group to oversee covert operations. So Jimmy Carter did all he could. And what's interesting is those efforts came to naught. And that's an interesting thing. But no, Jimmy Carter did not lose Iran. In a way, Khomeini won it.
I want to ask one more question, Ray, before we bring the rest of the group into the conversation. And it's really about what your takeaway is from the historical research you've done. Now, I know history doesn't repeat. It doesn't even need to rhyme. But one of the reasons we like to learn about history is we're hoping that by looking at what was done in the past, we can learn something about what to do today. So what sort of takeaway do you have for readers who want readers to take away from reading The Last Shah?
In terms of its implications for today, there are two different kind of legacies, I suppose, you can point to, or two lessons learned, for one for the Iranian side and for one for the American side. For the Iranian side, the mistakes that the Islamic Republic is making today are too similar to the mistakes of the Shah and to just the eerie similarities between the two, corruption, inability to reform, engaging in foreign policy whose costs are more obvious than benefits, a disaffected population that is not engaged in the political system, repressive security organs that look formidable but may not be. So the durability of the Islamic Republic is not a given. It should not be assumed. Now, the Islamic Republic leaders are made of tougher stuff than the Shah, so they may endure. But I think for those who say that the Islamic Republic faces a lot of problems, but after 40 years, its leaders know how to navigate the crises, those were exactly the same thing that were said about the Shah in 1978, 79. On the American side, and I use the Carter example, Carter tried very hard to change the domestic demarcations in Iran and failed. America will have a role in nudging Iranian politics one way or the other, but the future of Iran is likely to be determined by the Iranians themselves. America will have a role, but Iranians will likely to guide their own path. It is my view that Iranians were the primary drivers during this period, and they will be primary drivers in the future. And I will say one last thing. The history of Iran in the 20th century and into 21st century is a history of a nation, of a public, of a people who want democratic representation, and a series of governments who don't want them to have democratic representation. That struggle predated the Shah. It triumphed briefly during the Shah with the revolution, and it continues today. And it is my view that that struggle will define the future of Iran.
At this time, I'd like to invite members to join the conversation with their questions. I want to remind everybody that this meeting is on the record. And I believe now the operator will remind everyone how to join the question queue.
We will take our first question from Hani Fendakli.
Thank you very much, and thank you for a very interesting discussion. Last year I read Jack Straw's book, The English Job, on the subject, and he seems to portray the two pictures that you have discussed. One is about the Shah's conflicting and contradictory personality, and the other, Iranians' thirst for democracy and the conflict with government. And my question about the Shah and the conflict, and I wanted to know, he seems to have a reform program and try to implement that, and education and economic issues, dealing with rural and urban issues. But at the same time, he lived as if he was a member of a dynasty that goes thousands of years as the Shahanshah and things of that type. Does the fact that he lived a very lavish and pretentious life as a leader create a division between him and the Bazaris and the intellectuals, and basically brought about his downfall that would not have been possible had he acted as a ruler from the people for the people?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. At some level, the Shah's sensibilities were European. The vacations in Europe, the food was French, the cars were German, the wine was Italian. And he sort of had contempt for his own public. He was once asked, why don't you rule as a Scandinavian monarch? And he said, fine, give me Scandinavian subjects. So there was a disconnect between him and his public. For him, Iran was this great laboratory of social experimentation, not a country with traditions and history and contradictions and its own way of thinking. He wanted to superimpose a Western template on Iran's traditions, not appreciating the depth and the greatness of those traditions. By the time he got to 1970s, the Shah became a remote figure. He would go around the country in helicopters. He would talk to Western reporters. He was actually very revealing with Western reporters. And he kind of felt that that's what you do. He became gradually more disconnected from the Iranian public. He was rarely seen in public, but he was omnipresent. His picture and statues were everywhere, but he wasn't seen. So he became distant and detached and remote. And as I said, his sensibilities always were more European, both in terms of his conception of what Iran should look like and the people he liked to have. He liked to have people around him who were Western trained, as opposed to the old wily politician who knew the back ways of the Persian politics. And that, as you suggested, his alienation from his own public was an important aspect of his downfall. And I think that's a very important point that you raise.
We will take our next question from Paula Stern. Please remember to state your affiliation.
Thank you. It's the Stern Group. And I came a little bit late. I apologize if you've covered this. But I'm sure that everyone wants to ask you, what should Biden be doing now to pave the way towards some relationship that would be more positive than what we have seen in the last 4 years. But that's not my question. My question is about women. And I haven't had the pleasure of reading your book yet. It just came today, thank you. But it's my impression, and I had the great chance a year and a half or so ago of visiting Iran, being there for two weeks, purely no business, only as a tourist. And I was so impressed with the women and the role of women, even in this period where you have this strong fundamentalism coming out of the leadership. So could you, and it's my impression that that the Shah's wife, at least, had a lot to do with encouraging women's professional roles. Can you comment at all on that? Because I think that they're fundamentally extremely important, especially if we're going to pave the way to some better relationship with Iran.
Yes, the Shah was an unlikely agent of female emancipation and franchise. He did actually begin to say women have the right to vote. And that's one of the reasons why he got in trouble with the clerical estate, including Ayatollah Khomeini, because giving women the right to franchise, giving the women the right to access public facilities, universities, to essentially be participant in the country's profession, a trend that, as you have suggested, has gone on, irrespective of the Islamic Republic's attempt to clamp down on it. But at the same time, he had what can only be described as grotesque views of women. He thought they were inferior to men. He thought they were incapable of governing country. So he was, again, it is just kind of a contradiction. On the one hand, he essentially allowed women a greater role in the public affairs, but at the same time, in his interviews, and he was very open in his interviews about his sort of perception of women as subordinate to men, and justifiably so. And I think both those trends have continued in the post-Pahlavi period.
Our next question will be from Robert Jervis.
Thank you, Bob Jervis from Columbia University. My question is about whether the Shah's illness, his cancer that he had in the period of the revolution, affected his behavior, not only directly, but indirectly, and that I assume conventional wisdom is right, that his one of his main goals was to turn over power to his son. And that in the mid or early 70s, that schedule was out a very long time. The diagnosis of cancer changed the schedule and meant that he had to, his son might have to take over sooner. Then speculation that that affected his decisiveness or lack of it, his views about using force. What do you think?
Thanks, Bob. I thought you were going to ask me about intelligence failure because you and I have talked about that before. With some modest disagreements between us, but Shah's cancer that came about in 1974, it is, as you said, suggested that cancer hampered his decision-making and contributed his indecisiveness. I tend to believe he was indecisive before, and cancer was not necessarily the cause of his inability to make decisions once we get to the latter stages of the revolution. However, as you do suggest, the cancer finding made him realize that the political system had to change, that he didn't have confidence that his son could manage a political system where every decision was made by a single person and no decision could have been made without the sanction. I mean, the level of Shah's decision-making, when we say he made all the decisions, I mean, you know, military flights could not have come into Tehran without his permission. I mean, just think about a level of detail here. So I think in 1974, 75, and he begins to speak about this actually, that we have to essentially accelerate the process of liberalization, recreating the institutions. Essentially, he wanted to go back to pre-1960s political system where you had parliaments, politicians, institutions, that could help a ruler. So in a way, he recognized his own mistakes in centralizing power and eviscerating those institutions. I do believe that the timeline was dramatically speeded up, and speed kills. But I don't necessarily think that cancer affected his judgment, made him more indecisive, because I think he was always indecisive. But you're quite right. It does expedite the plan to liberalize without having a clear conception what liberalization actually looks like.
Our next question will be from Robert Francis.
Oh, my apologies. I think I hit the wrong button.
No worries. Our next question will be from Mansoor Shams.
Hello, my name is Mansoor Shams, and I'm the founder of MuslimMarine.org. I want to kind of piggyback off the previous question, which was about the way forward when it comes to the Biden-Harris administration. And with all this happened in the last, from taking it from the Obama administration, where there was some level of cooperation and, you know, conversation going on, to the Trump administration, where that all ended, and now to the Biden-Harris administration, what do you see as the path forward? What would be your advice? It seems like right now, you know, everyone's on the opposite ends. I'd just like to get your input, advice, or thoughts on the way forward, and, you know, what do you think happens next? Thank you very much.
I think President Biden should support the Shah and help him. But to answer your question, at this point, there is actually consensus in both Washington and Tehran. There's a consensus in Washington that the Iran nuclear deal is deficient and requires renegotiations. And there's a consensus in Iran that none of this is going to happen. I would say one of the things I would focus on on an issue that has been overwhelmed by arms control debate and discussions is I am not prepared to concede to the necessary durability of the regime. Now, what that means, it invites a whole set of concerns and problems, of course. But I do think that anybody who looks at the Islamic Republic today can be impressed to some extent by its resilience and the crises that it has handled, but cannot concede to the notion that somehow the clerical rulers have managed to gain the keys to autocratic stability that eluded most of their monarchical predecessors, not just the Shah, almost every Iranian king. Shah's father, the Qajar dynasty, before eventually came to expiration. So I will say that one of the principal legacies of the revolution, one of the ironic legacies of the revolution is that there is none. The stuff that people say about the Islamic Republic today, it can handle its problems, it's been around for a long time, those things were said precisely in 1978, 79. There's information and sort of erased. So I would not be surprised if during the times of Biden presidency or so forth, you begin to see some degree of internal convulsions within Iran. And the United States has to kind of figure out what that means and how it's going to address that situation. We always tend to be surprised by political developments in Iran. To some extent, we were surprised by the revolution itself. But the internal politics of Iran and the possibility of the Islamic Republic come under serious populist challenge, and the challenges that represents for the United States as it focuses on arms control is something that people should be thinking about, in my opinion.
Our next question is from Frank Wisner.
I am, like a previous speaker, delighted to have just last night received a copy of your book, and I'm excited to read it.
Thank you.
I want to take you back to an earlier period, to the Mossadegh 1953 period. The operative assumption in Washington at the time was that Iran teetered on the prospect of control by the Tudeh Party and the communists, and that Iran could be taken over by the communists and slip into the communist bloc. Therefore, we had to take all measures possible. As you look back at the historical record, was that threat properly analyzed? How exaggerated or less exaggerated was it? How dangerous was the prospect of a two-day party takeover?
I think it was exaggerated. We looking over all the records as I have seen it, I would say one thing. The American government's analysis of Iran, both the diplomatic corps and the agency, having read yards and yards of it, was actually quite good. And what the agency was at that time suggesting is not so much that the Today Party is about to take over, but that Dr. Mossadegh, as his coalition narrows, will increasingly rely more and more on leftist elements and bring them to his government. And this was a time when many communist parties were coming to power in the Soviet bloc and elsewhere by first participating as coalition partners. And so the fear was that as he becomes isolated and his inability to resolve the oil issue essentially will make him more and more progressively more reliable on the left, and that could invite a gradual absorption of government. I do think even that was exaggerated. The Today Party was an organized party, and it has certainly a degree of presence and strength among the student population and industrial working group, but I don't believe that it was poised to assume control. The second thing I would say that's very interesting about this affair is the stuff that we're finding in the Soviet archives. Because if the Americans knew what the Russians were saying, they would be surprised how clueless the Soviets were. Throughout the 1953 crisis in Iran, under the ignorant and ill-informed leadership of Foreign Minister Molotov, the official Soviet line was that Dr. Mossadegh was an agent of America trying to nationalize the British oil companies in order to pave the way for American imperial takeover. And therefore, we, the Soviet Union, are not going to assist Dr. Mossadegh. As a matter of fact, the Soviet Union's Politburo recognizes that Mossadegh was not an agent of the United States in the year 1957. 4 years after he was deposed, they have a meeting, and that meeting was designed to expel Molotov. And among the charges against Foreign Minister Molotov by Khrushchev was that he misapprehended the situation in Iran. And it was only at that time that the Soviet Union reclassified Dr. Mossadegh's movement as a nationalist one. So if Americans could only have peeked into the Soviet archives, they would have to say, these are the guys we're worrying about?
Our next question will be from Mark Feldman. Mr. Feldman, if you could unmute your microphone.
Thank you very much for this fascinating talk. I'm with Georgetown Law these days. My question is this. The narrative Carter lost Iran, the narrative that the Shah was indecisive, and it's his own responsibility, both often or seem to presuppose that the use of military force at the height of the crisis would have had a happy outcome, some kind of a positive outcome. I'd like to hear your thoughts on that subject.
We have the advantage of having the record of the Iranian generals' deliberations. They created in the late 1978 what they call the Commander's Council, where they essentially discussed what to do. And that council featured all the leading generals of all the military branches, including the secret police, the Sabbagh. The Islamic Republic has been actually paradoxically generous to historians. It has released many of the Shah's records, including the records of his secret police. But looking at the deliberations of the Iranian military leaders at the height of the crisis, it was the blind leading the deaf. that there were, these were not men capable of having a coup. I would say one thing about the American deliberations, and this goes to Bob Jervis's point, his other point about intelligence failure. The one persistent intelligence failure that the United States made in Iran from 1978 all the way to February 11, 1979, when the revolution succeeded, was the belief that the Iranian army at the top was cohesive enough and strong enough to take over and assume control of the situation, even if the Shah faltered. And that was a core misjudgment, because from that misjudgment, all the other misjudgments can be explained. There was, that military was not capable of instituting a coup in any sort of a way, even when Carter and Dr. Brzezinski wanted to do so. I would say one thing about the deliberations of the United States government in 1979, 78, that may be true today. In 1978, there was a debate between Secretary of State Cyrus Vance and National Security Advisor Zbigniew Brzezinski. Zbigniew Brzezinski wanted a crackdown, and Cy Vance wanted a coalition government between the Shah and the oppositions. Both Brzezinski and Vance were correct about each other's position. Vance was correct that there was no military solution, and Brzezinski was correct that there was no possibility of a coalition government. That impasse persists to some extent, maybe today. Today there's an argument between those who think the Islamic Republic can reform itself and there's a possibility of arms control agreement, and those who believe that the regime collapsed. It may be that both parties are right again about each other's position. But I would say that to your core question, it is my belief that that military could not discharge its obligation, to not discharge a coup. Now, to be fair, many other historians of Iran who are sympathetic to the Shah have suggested that if the Shah ordered them to do so, they would do so, but that order never came. I tend to be skeptical of that. Having read their deliberations, these were not men capable of doing that.
Our next question comes from Rita Hauser. Ms. Hauser, if you can unmute your microphone. We seem to be having technical difficulties, so we'll go on to our next one. Our next question is from Herman Cohen.
Good evening. I have a question about the revolution's attitude toward Israel. From the beginning, they were extremely hostile, even more than any Arab country. What is behind that?
What is behind the hostility? Anti-Semitism. Khomeini, in his statement of the Islamic government, his book that essentially conditioned, had outlines what the Islamic Republic looked like. The book was published in the early 1970s. In the introduction of the book, he talks about the fact that Jews have essentially created all these problems for the Muslim community and so forth. And that has been a strain within the Iranian clerical community predating Khomeini, a sort of hostility to the Jewish population and therefore the Jewish state and the embrace of the Palestinian cause. It is not just anti-Zionism, as the Iranian leaders would like to suggest, but there is, in my opinion, a very ugly strain of anti-Semitism that colors the clerical community's approach toward Israel and the larger Jewish community. And this comes up occasionally over denials of the Holocaust. It came out particularly during the presidency of Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, but there isn't anybody in the top echelons of the clerical leadership that actually believe Holocaust happened, or it happened in the way that historians understand it.
Our next question comes from Hung Idalapur.
Yes, hello. I am an independent translator and interpreter in the DC area. I find myself going back to the historical record. I especially Professor Ervand Ebrahamian's book, Iran Between Two Revolutions, comes to mind, in which he mentioned, he says that there was essentially uneven development under the Shah. Economic development or even overdevelopment, but political underdevelopment. Well, the political underdevelopment, we know there was. I mean, your book, I don't have the book in hand, but from what I read about it, it seems you agree with that. I mean, he even hollowed out his own political elite, such as they were, the Shah. But from what you were saying, and also what we know from the late 70s, his economic development also didn't work that well. So I'm wondering, do you think in the end, I don't think what I'm asking is too simplistic. In the end, the combination of the two, there really wasn't a track record of success in either. Was that what basically was the undoing of him? One thing. Secondly, you mentioned earlier about the fundamental inhumanity of the Shah. I have looked really, really in depth at the human rights records of the Shah, and I've talked to some of his former diplomats, some of whom have already passed away, of course. And people who had been in the court, people who had talked to him, people who had been in the foreign ministry, and one of them in particular was telling me as recently as 4 or 5 years ago, the Shah was so humane. He was such a caring human being. He couldn't hurt a fly. And I would ask this gentleman, but then how do you reconcile that with what he allowed the Sabbagh to do? And he really couldn't. So I would be interested in your comments on both of those.
Yes, on the question, you're obviously correct about political underdevelopment. Economic development was halting. It was uneven. Corruption was a big factor. But I do think that the public was benefiting. Not every segment of public was benefiting to the same degree at the same pace. But there were, you know, there was what we would call trickle-down economy, but not much was trickling down. On the issue of Sabbagh, and this is a bit controversial. There is no question about Sabbagh's use of torture and other such things. But I think in retrospect, the record has demonstrated that international human rights organizations' investigations in the 1970s on this matter in the National Committee of Jurors were exaggerated. It is Islamic Republic's figures, and I think Professor Abrahamian cites it, I'm going to cite it from memory, that from 1966 to 1979, about 2,500 Iranians were killed in terms of political protests. That included the revolution. The Sabbagh as an institution, and we have the records, and we can assess it carefully, does actually go through some kind of a change in the 1970s. It begins to be as less reliant on torture just because it didn't work, and essentially develop this elaborate surveillance state where the Shah was actually bugging everybody. There is a volume of Sabbagh files that is called The Women of the Court. The Shah was spying on his wife and mother. I mean, you have to think about Sabbagh of the 1970s as Stasi, where everybody was spying on everybody. Now, it was unclear what they did with all that information they got, but the lack of information by the Sabbagh was not a factor. And if you look at their files, and I have looked at them a bit, I need to look at them more, they actually knew exactly what was happening in every mosque. They knew what was happening in people's homes. They knew what was happening in political discussions. They knew a great deal of information. The question is, just because you have information, that doesn't mean your policy will succeed. In the Korean War, the Chinese told the North Koreans, MacArthur will land at this spot on Thursday at 3. So the question about intelligence information in a society like that, in an autocracy like that, is not so much that there is information, is how is this transmitted to the leadership and how does leadership understand it? For most of this period, the head of Sabbagh was a General Nasseri, who was rude and quite unintelligent and notoriously corrupt. it's hard for me to see that he go to the court and saying, boss, you got a problem. So the information was there, but in terms of how that information was extracted, this is in no way whatsoever to justify the crimes of Sabbagh, but to suggest that there's an evolution in the way the organization approach gathering of information.
Thank you, Ray. I think you've given everyone a taste of the excellent work you have done in the Last Shah. I want to thank everyone for joining today's virtual book launch. I want to let everybody also know you can purchase a copy of The Last Shah through CFR's website. And just let everybody know that there will be an audio and transcript of today's meeting posted on CFR's website. So again, thank you, Ray. Thank you, everybody who tuned in. Stay well.
Thank you very much for having me. Thanks.